of time in the cellular telephone industry, and so I was delighted when in the summer of 2001, I was contacted by an old friend of mine from the industry who had started a new cellular telephone company. I was immediately surprised that there would be an entrepreneurial opportunity in cellular after all these years. But what he had done was convinced an investor to put $6 million into his company, and he built this extraordinary technology platform that was going to revolutionize the prepaid cellular business. It was the piece of the cellular world that was still available to some entrepreneurial thinking. The big guys didn't like prepaid, the service where you pay in advance, a service that inherently attracted only people of low credit, poor credit, of people of low income. And so prepaid customers were customers with low revenue. Prepaid customers were customers with high churn. And those were things that cellular companies obviously wanted to avoid. So they sort of dismissed prepaid. Well, my friend had developed a technology that was going to allow him to revolutionize prepaid by bringing it into local retail distribution. You would no longer need to acquire cellular service only from an authorized cellular company that could initiate service for you, that could turn the phone on for you, but rather this friend's technology was going to allow you to turn on your phone yourself. And so you could sell it at a grocery store. You could sell it right there at the cash register like a loaf of bread. And he thought that innovative distribution strategy would be a good way to build a prepaid company. Well, what had happened though in the couple of years that it took for him to build this technology platform, what had happened was that the big guys did get excited about prepaid. And AT&T and other companies were now aggressively selling prepaid. So my friend recognized that he needed something more than just simply a good distribution strategy. He needed something with additional distinction, with a new story, because he needed to raise some money. He had invested almost all that $6 million in the technology platform itself. He needed to raise some money to go to market. He wanted a powerful story that was going to allow him to raise that additional money. And it was a time that it was quite difficult to raise money. It was the summer of 2001. It was soon thereafter the NASDAQ bubble had burst. It was at that point in time where, before the NASDAQ bubble burst, the venture capitalists had invested about $32 billion in startups. The year after the NASDAQ bubble burst, the number was more like about $6 billion. And most of that $6 billion, quite frankly, was used to invest in their current companies and companies that they had previously invested in. So it was going to be a hard time to raise money. It was the worst time in my adulthood to raise money for a startup. So my friend recognized he needed a powerful story. It reminded me immediately of the wonderful British literary figure Samuel Johnson and one of his aphorisms, which I think I paraphrased, but I think fairly closely. And that is that one's mind is never so clear as it is when you're on your way to the gallows. What that means is that for so many businesses, the very best thinking that they'll do is the thinking that they'll permit themselves to do when they're at a desperate time. And my friend and his cellular company was at a desperate time.